Hello everyone, this is our first lecture on Mendel Economics and Resource Management. So we start this with this question that why actually we study this subject. The first thing we need to understand here is that the resources we have are limited. In case of mining operation, our resources are the initial investment, the manpower we have, the machineries we have, etc. So, in this course, we will learn about the technique that we generally use to efficiently achieve our goals with the limited resources we have. For example, let's say exploration. Suppose if we had huge number of manpower and investment and machinery and all, we could have started mining from the topsoil itself. But rather what we do, we first explore the places where the concentration is high. We set a cutoff, and only the ore that crosses the cutoff, we process that part only, so that economically we can develop our minerals and all. Similarly, further in this course, we will also learn about the features of mineral resources, which makes the Mendel economics slightly different from other economic affairs. We will learn about the finances of our mining projects, and finally, we would also learn about the managerial aspects that are used in a mining enterprise. Economics is basically the science that studies the production and consumption behavior of goods and services. Similarly, Mendel economics is the economic study in the field of mineral generation and consumption. In our domestic and industrial application, we use several kind of goods that we get through mining industry. The most common is energy material, that is oil and coal, etc. Another important thing are the precious materials, that is gold, silver, etc., which are generally used as base currencies. And next to precious metals, we have our base metals, ferrous metals, materials like titanium, aluminium, which are known for being light and have their unique application. And we have nuclear materials, and even our construction materials, gemstones, fertilizers, and many such things we get from mining operations. And most of the mining resources that we use are actually in non-renewable nature. The renewable natural resources are that water, sunlight, which have a higher rate of generation, or rather say regeneration. And non-renewable resources are those which doesn't generate itself, or the generation rate is very slow. For example, that saltpeter, and even the gold deposition in gold vein, they are very slow process. That's why we categorize they regenerate themselves, but that process is very slow. That's why we count them as non-renewable resources. And ore is basically the resource that crosses a particular cutoff grade. That's what it becomes economic to extract. So ore is basically mineral resource, a mineral body that is economic to extract. And next we have the legal categorization of our minerals. The legal categorization is important for mining engineers, because for economic activity there are interests of many stakeholders. That's why having a legal definition for it helps in case of when conflicts or some disagreement about which is that taxable mineral and which is non-taxable mineral. For clearing that kind of doubt, a legal definition was important. So for this purpose, we have Mines and Minerals Development and Regulation Act. That act, in its first schedule, categorizes minerals in major minerals in mainly three parts, that is part A, B and C. In part A it has energy minerals, in part B it mentions all the atomic minerals, and in part C it mentions all metallic and non-metallic major minerals. And it also has a definition of minor minerals that mainly includes that stone, gravels and clay and etc., that mostly things that are used as construction material. So from our elements of mining courses, we know that we get minerals from deposits. And if we see them in a economic perspective, there are several unique features mineral deposits have. First, that we already discussed, most of the mineral resources are non-renewable in nature, and they are finite. And so while we are exploiting mineral deposits, we have to keep thinking about our future generation. And next is uncertainty about quantity and grade, because it is not possible to thoroughly explore the whole deposit. That means unless you start exploiting, it doesn't make sense that you thoroughly explore everything. So there is always an uncertainty associated with a mineral deposit. And next thing is geology. That means how much feasible or how much geologically feasible mining something is, mining our body is. And that suitability. Maybe that there is a very good reserve, but that is very few kilometers below. So with the current technology you have, it is not possible to go for mining it, or rather say you have an easier deposit around. So such kind of deposit is not suitable for you. Or suitability in the term that some deposit is very much uneven or very much steep, so that existing method you have expertise in, that you cannot access, that you cannot mine with those methods. So for you, that is not suitable deposit. And that another concept is usability. Maybe that let's say monazite, that a sand that contains thorium, and it contains also the rare earth minerals. So that sand is that monazite sand is a special, obviously it is a mineral resource, but at this point we don't have sufficient technological things that we can economically extract monazite and to do our stuff. But maybe because when we'll have thorium reactors, that mining monazite will become an economic thing, because that other than our rare earth, we will also get value for our thorium that's in monazite. And next thing is technology. That is, maybe all things are satisfying, but you don't have the technology for mining. So let's see in the next slide that what I was saying, that maybe your deposit is so steep, and the expertise you have that you know only how to mine well the flat deposit. So this is not very much accessible deposit, very much good deposit for you. And depth is also a factor, because this one you can simply mine with surface mining. So in case of surface mining, your economics is different, but this one you have to mine with underground mining. The economics of these two deposits are quite different. This is the main essence of this talk. And other than your technical things, there are several non-technical aspects also of a mineral deposit that actually we in economic point of view we have to see. That is location related peculiarity, because when the minerals formed, it was a geological process. That time it didn't care about borders and all. In many a time you will find that a deposit, half of it is in one state and another one is other state. So maybe in case of coal deposit, it's the one body coal India, but suppose it is somewhat of a minor mineral, and permit from both of the states are to be taken. In that case, some clashes, I should not say clash, but some problems may come. Another thing is perpetuality. Maybe there is a good deposit, but above it there is a lake, or there is the land above it is being used for some other purpose, let's say agriculture. So the land you may need for mining, that may have some other application. So while you are evaluating that deposit, you have to also consider that what structure or what thing is above the deposit that has to be removed. So that cost also you have to encounter while you are economically trying to see a deposit. And the socio-economic factor that impact of mining and etc. That environment also comes under this point. And next thing is geopolitics. That you know about that cobalt thing that we keep saying that China is actually aiding illegal mining of cobalt in Democratic Republic of Congo. And we also have cobalt in our Indian Ocean, but that has the name of Indian Ocean, but other countries, even the landlocked countries too, have their rights in the Indian Ocean. So we just cannot go straight away and mine it without having a global convention. And finally, the most important thing about a mineral deposit is uncertainty of investment, because when you are doing an economic activity, you need investors. It can be state, it can be the private sector. And in case of my mineral deposit, that getting investment is often different than kind of investment you need for an agricultural farm or something, because it is a high investment thing, and that it has some uncertainty associated with it. Because you may initially think with initial borehole data it is a good deposit, but it may happen that when you start mining, it may become not that good deposit. So that uncertainty in the economic investment terms is always there in case of our mineral deposits. So far we discussed various parameters that we can see to judge a mineral resource. But however, for application purpose, we cannot go about considering all the parameters and come up with a resource classification scheme. To make things simple, we select only few parameters that are most important. Here we have a scheme that is proposed by USGS and widely known as USGS classification for mineral resources. So it mainly takes two parameters. That is, in y-axis it gives economic feasibility, and in this horizontal axis about that how much certainty that resource has, or that how much we are certain about the existence of that deposit. So it has terms like demonstrated means we exactly know it is there, means either it has been mined by some initial mining has been done, or some huge number of boreholes are there, and there is undiscovered resource, that is either hypothesized that certain kind of geological condition is there, and in another place that similar kind of geological condition was there, so that mineral was found there. So it may so happen that it is also there. So that kind of hypothesis or speculation is there. So that is not yet undiscovered. That is yet not discovered. And in boundary between that demonstrated and undiscovered is inferred. That means you have sufficient data that you have a good enough certainty that it is there, but you are not 100% sure or not aware about the overall quantity of the reserve and all. And in Y vertical axis we have economic feasibility, and if that resource we have, if it is very economic to mine, so then it is economic, and then it is marginally economic and sub-economic. Sub-economic means not not at all economic. So, and takeaway from this slide is this classification scheme defines what the mineral reserve is. This kind of question you may also incur in your Viva and all, that what is difference between a resource and a reserve. So a reserve is an identified resource that is economic to mine. Just take the same example of monazite that we discussed, that we know that monazite is a resource, that in monazite there are rare earth minerals, in monazite there is thorium, but is it economic to mine? If that is not, then that may be identified. Just let's say that southeastern coast of India, we know there is monazite reserves are there, or we also say that thorium reserve is there, but that's not quite economic at this moment to mine. So that's why that is not effectively a reserve. Or say the monazite reserves of USA. Even USA is not mining it, rather it is buying rare earth minerals from China. So resource is everything, and reserve is a part of it that is identified and economic to mine. And that the reserve that is not well identified, only inferred, we call it inferred reserve. So this is the takeaway from this slide. And however, this inferred and hypothetical speculative, don't take them as a qualitative word. The study material that is provided with you, that is USGS classification PDF, they have actually properly defined what is called an inferred resource, and what is hypothetical, what is speculative, and what is sub-economic. Every term has been defined well, because for me, what I may think is inferred, you may consider that as a hypothetical if we go independently. That's why these terminologies are well defined. Now, this was the a classification scheme based on your certainty of the reserve and economic feasibility only. And then we have another important classification system, that is United Nations Framework Classification, or shortly called as UNFC. Material for this one is also shared with you. So it is basically, instead of having two parameters, it takes three parameters. That's why it is also called a three-axis classification system. Here, in this axis, you have geology. In terms of geology, how much exploration has been done about that resource. And in this axis, you have feasibility, means how much feasibility study has been taken on that ore body or resource base. And in this vertical axis, you have your economic feasibility. So this block 111, it is studied well, it is geologically explored, and it is also economic. So this 111 block is a good kind of reserve, and by these blocks are coded by these three numbers. That is, 111 means that first thing is 1, second thing is 1, third thing is also 1. So only these three codes we consider as reserves. That means your geology is 1, your feasibility is 1, your economic is 1. That means it's a reserve. If it is 1-2-1, that means geology is 1, feasibility is 2, and economic is 1. Then also we consider it as a reserve. And similarly, it goes for 1-2-3, and these are just codes. In the study material, you will have a full list of codes, that what that codes actually mean, and depending on codes, how we classify our reserve. That kind of thing is discussed in the study material given to you. So in our next Google Meet, we basically expect that you will come with a lot of questions that we will discuss there. So thank you very much. See you soon.